James, James Taylor. It's the morning. Woo! Suppose I better watch where I'm going. James, what would you like to follow up on this morning? Sorry, I had to race out. Wonderful. I'm just gone on to Shortcut Gallego now. I'll just stand by until I hear Aubrey or somebody out, and then I'll check the little pan. Okay, copy. Thanks, James. Right, so we've got a plan. James and I have both decided that we're going to try and find the lions first this morning. So we'll put a concerted effort, because they were apparently being so sneaky yesterday. Right, just checking for tracks. Now, I don't actually even know how much rain we've had. I suppose that's not too much of a problem. Let's maybe light it up here. Where's my little lights? David, I've forgotten where... Oh, it's these. Jumping around from vehicle to vehicle is always quite interesting. Forget where the buttons are sometimes. There are lots of buttons to press. It's a bit like Dexter's Lab in here sometimes. Now, this is going to be interesting because of the rain that we had. It started at about 2 o'clock, maybe just before 2. Little pitter-patter that I heard on my window. Well, and then it went from a pitter-patter to quite some heavy rain. Right, now it's almost time to start the show, so I'm going to leave you, but I'll catch you soon. Let's go across to James.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
good morning everybody, and welcome to Safari Live. Standing by. Everyone, my name is James Henry. On camera today, Brian. Storm cloud today, Brian?
Usual morning. Oh,
the morning Thai thumb. Good. Well, he's going to need an overcoat. There has been probably some, I'd say about an inch or so of soft soaking rain during the night, so that's very good. That will make all the animals out here happy. The cicadas are calling, the frogs are calling in the distance, so hopefully we'll see some of them during the course of the day. There's a lovely feeling about the morning. We don't know what's happened with the lions. They were calling very vociferously until probably about 10 o'clock last night or so. Then I fell asleep, so I don't know whether they were calling after that. But Taylor's gone around towards Gallego Pan. We're going to head round towards the dam camera and see what's going on there. We may find those lions. We might also find a leopard. We might find wild dogs. We might just find termites. Termites love the days like this because the ground is soft and the culmination of their existence happens now. The flying alates, the flying termites, start to emerge, and there are one or two actually as I speak now. So that's the story today. We're going to explore in the rain. It's going to be great fun. As I said, my name is James Henry, and if you would like to talk to me or Taylor, who's on the other vehicle, during the course of the morning, please do talk to us on Twitter, hashtag Safari Live, or questions at wildearth.tv if you are on the email. Right, Brian, shall we carry on?
Mm.
Yeah, it's good. Let's do that. We nearly started in the tent this morning, everybody, and for those of you who don't know, the tent is our sort of rain set, if you like. But we decided, well, Brian basically convinced us that A, we didn't want to do 3 hours in the tent, and B, the rain was sufficiently stopped for us to carry on. So here we are, out in the field, thanks to Brian Joubert and his very, very well decked out morning thumb. Very nice. In the final control this morning, Louise Pavide. She is being ably assisted by Kirsten Max-Smith. And still in bed, Stefan Winterboer and Connor Teagues. It is, of course, only 0500 in the morning, which is a very early time, and Byron, of course, is also still in bed. So it is very early in the morning, and it is the best time to be out here. And I'm told that it's 21 degrees Celsius and 69 degrees Fahrenheit. I'd say that's probably fairly accurate, with a bit of chill factor tossed in for the moisture and the wind coming out of the southeast. Now we'll drive very carefully along the road and see if we've got any tracks of lions or leopards. I do find the wild dogs like to move on days like this, so we might be lucky. But apparently one of the packs, in fact this is quite interesting, one of the packs, I don't know if you were on drive with us two mornings ago, when there were two packs on Torchwood, they had a bit of a scuffle. But one of them moved off down into the Kruger, and it went as far as a place called Afsal, which is about 25 kilometers, or what is that in miles? Call that about 18 miles or so to the south of Skukuza. Now that is from here about, gosh, I mean that's almost 50 miles from here. And they had moved down there where one of them got quite badly injured and they were darted. And there's been quite a lot of consternation over trying to look after them. Anyway, that is some of the distances that they move. Huge, huge distances. No lion tracks yet. I may have to add an additional jersey to my makeup. Brian, it's quite cold. How many jackets today?
Only two.
Oh, Brian's only got two jackets on, everybody, which for Brian is basically a hot summer's day, isn't it, Brian? Let's have a look there. Now, what we're going to do is just put the camera over there towards the burgeoning mist.
No,
we're not.
No.
Okay, we're not going to do that. Let's head across to Tayla and... oh, yes. Let's head across to Tayla and find out what her plans for the morning are.
Good morning again and welcome to a very damp... an insecty, I suppose you could describe it, as this morning's sunrise drive will be. My name is Tayla, and on camera with me, I've got David. There he is. Now, I'm very excited, of course, because I'd like to see the Nkhumas. I heard them calling all night long, which was quite nice. And I, like I said in the pre-show, I know they were being quite sneaky and hiding away from you all yesterday. But hopefully they've decided to come out. It sounded like they were around one of the lodges, perhaps in their favorite drainage line, which is very difficult to try and sort of find them in. However, the reason why I'm actually excited is it seems as though some alates have been released. Now, if you're wondering what alates are, well, for termites, it's the princes and the princesses of the princes and the princesses. Hang on, we've got a vulture over there. Let's have a look at them and just see what if it's just roosting. Now, they're quite small. I'll try and catch one for you. I don't think it's going to be particularly difficult. And basically, they've been released from the mounds to go and repopulate. But I don't know if it's termites. It could be ants, which, if I'm not mistaken, it's just the females, just the virgin queens that go around. However, what I know we're going to see, and I'm watching it happen now, with all these beautiful calls that we're hearing, the birds are going to be out having a feeding frenzy. So it's going to be a fantastic birding morning. Look at the little birchall starling. Can you see it just there? Now, I'll probably try and go ahead, but there's a couple of them. Looks like a couple of Cape Glossy starlings too. And they're all flying around. There we go, trying to catch these alates. It's just sitting up there. So you'll see lots of diving and swooping around as they try and find a spot where they have been released, and hopefully we're able to find a spot where they're sort of coming out of the ground. But I will confirm as to which species is. These birds are actually having a bit of a dispute at the moment. There are lots of these alates flying around. They're quite tiny, so it may be a little bit difficult for you to see. There we go. Did you see one of them flying just behind the bird? They almost look like dragonflies, but very floppy dragonflies. Oh, it caught one! Oh my goodness, fantastic. It was very quick. That birchall starling that just flew into the distance actually swooped into the air and grabbed some breakfast. Now they are very nutritional, they're very high in protein. Isn't that wonderful? Here's another one going to have a go. Oh yes, it caught one too. See, they're not particularly fast flying. These two, here you go, you can see it eating. These elates are not very quick now, so they need to really sort of move away. Who have we got here? Is this a... Look at this one right in front of us. It's one of the swallows. Is there one on this tree here? There we go. With a big white breast. Ooh, aren't you beautiful? Now, I wonder if this is perhaps not a violet-backed starling. It doesn't look very violet-coloured right now. Let's have a look, just because of the light. But there's very few birds that have got such a white breast like that, with a colour over the top of their head. And I suspect that in the sun it would shine a lovely purple colour, but we can double check. We can always have a look. Otherwise, it's a bird that I've never seen before. Let me get my nifty app out. See, this morning I've been a little bit reluctant to bring my books out with me. I did bring a couple because of the rain. They're so... Was it also eating one? What have you got there? Sorry, I'm a little bit reluctant to bring my books out just because of the terrible weather that we had earlier. But I did bring a bird book, but let's have a quick look here and just confirm that it was the bird we saw. Let's have a look here. Come and have a look at this. Let's turn my phone. If you have a look there. Now, even in this picture, it's just the way that the screen is angled. You can see how blue it looks. It's not actually blue. Let's see if I change the... No, it's not really doing it too much justice. But it's actually a lovely purple color. It's purple on my phone. Like I said, I think it's just the reflection. But it's nice to see that the violet-backed starlings, or the old name was the plum-colored starlings, are back in business and have arrived again. Isn't that quite exciting? So I hope you're prepared today for a morning of birding. I know I am. And hopefully we'll get some lions along the way too. But this is really, really fascinating. And like I said, one thing I'm going to look out for is I'm going to be scouring the ground and checking to see if I can see where these alates are coming out of, whether they're ant alates, whether they are termite alates. I'm not certain just yet. We'll need to try and catch one as well. Perhaps I'll have to run around for you at some point and see if I'm as quick as the birds and is able to snatch one up. Although, David, yes. If you open your mouth nice and wide as we drive, I suppose you could catch one in your mouth too. David said he's going to try. He's got his mouth wide open now, trying to get them in. I'll probably do the same. So we'll just drive around like this today. They're very tasty, actually. Like I said, very good in protein. I don't think we'll enjoy them as much as the birds, unfortunately. But some of them, and I don't know if you've ever seen a driver ant before, maybe we'll... I actually find them in the vehicle. So one morning I'll see if I can pick up a driver ant. Well, I'm not going to eat one of those because I've eaten one in my life and one is enough, but it tasted very much like peanut butter, sort of a very buttery, strange taste. You're going to have to take my word on this. Otherwise, you might have to go sort of foraging around your garden or in the woods and look for some termites yourself. Now, there are lots of vultures all perched up in the trees this morning. Look, have a look at this one. They don't look very happy today, of course, because of their very wet feathers. Lots of white-backed vultures. Now, I wonder if they haven't just been following the lions around. And I've said it a couple of times, it is quite typical for them to do this. Because remember, at one point, the lions were hanging around Mamba, Drakensberg, Cheetah Cutline, and we just had hordes of vultures sort of sitting in the trees. I know we did have some carcasses, but they weren't always all feeding on those carcasses at that time. Now, that's quite typical, especially when you're so successful like the Nkhumas. It seems as though at this time of the year, if you just follow them around, you're almost guaranteed a meal. So let's continue here. Tracking, well, that is going to be a different story today. As, the water from last night washed away all the lovely footprints in the sand. We had quite a bit of rain. It was a nice, gentle soaking rain, which is what we really want. When we have those torrential downpours, you get a lot of erosion, which of course can be sort of quite detrimental to the environment. We see, you know, areas just washing away all the beautiful nutrients, which is not great. So, I think we're going to have to drive a little bit in 4x4 here. I don't want to wreck the road. We'll just take it easy. See, the worst thing as well is as we go through these drainages, there's quite a bit of erosion already. But if your wheels spin unnecessarily, you tear up the roads. And then, of course, when you get another downpour of rain, you cause further erosion. And that's one of the reasons why we do go into low range, where you lock all the wheels. And then you don't need to drive fast. You just sort of take it easy. And I think that's what we're going to do today. No racing around unless those pesky wild dogs come across, wherever they may be. I'm not even sure. I haven't seen the dogs yet. Right, now we can go out of 4x4 for that little incline. Right, I'm going to carry on searching around here and see if I can pick up any sign of those Nkhumas, but let's go back across to James.
Now, as Taylor was explaining, there are some areas we're not going to be allowed to drive today, and Aubrey's just updated us as to which areas those are, and that's to save the roads. And because if you have a destroyed road, of course, you have a sort of vector for soil erosion. So finding the cats today is going to be a little bit difficult if they happen to be on Twin Dams or on Mvubu Road, which is where they've been spending most of their time over the last few days. So I don't know if we're going to see them. We might be lucky, we might not, but we do have to look after, of course, the long-term viability of this ecosystem, shall we say. Brian, there's our first mammal.
Wonderful.
Yes, an impala. They look very terrified. I think they're just gold. We'll just get into a position where we can deafen them with Jigger's brakes. You can see they are very wet indeed. They're also very pregnant, and they're also very scared.
Some of them zoom apart. We're just on central approaching Gari Katlan. It's just myself here. I can't see any males. It just looks like three.
Isn't that nice? Looks like Taylor's had some success with the cats, so that's good news. They've all stuck their hair out, of course, in an attempt to try and stay warm and stay dry. They'll try and shake the water off their fur. All righty. I'm not entirely sure if Taylor's going to be able to stay with those lions for any length of time because of where they are. So let's head straight across to them and enjoy the playful little Nkhuma cubs.
Look at all these beautiful footprints on the lovely wet sand. Now, these are easy to identify. I suppose they don't need any introduction. And then, of course, we have got the beautiful creatures that have left the footprints behind. Look at them all chasing and running around. Look at the little cubs getting naughty. We're having a look at us. Well, let's try not stay away from them for too long. Let's go a bit closer. Like James said, if they venture off into any of the drainage lines today, I'm afraid, it seems as though Aubrey seems to think we had anywhere between 50 and 20 mils of rain last night. But because it was so slow and soaking, that's given the ground an opportunity to sort of absorb it and not leave the big puddles on the road. Now, we won't be able to off-road, unfortunately. It's just too much rain and we're going to be tearing up the ground. But hello, lovelies. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can only see 4 lionesses here. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I think I saw 8 cubs. I'm just going to pull off slightly so we can have a look at them all playing in the road. Hello, guys. You can see the lionesses are very playful this morning. And it's just the most beautiful sound here, all the birds waking up. Oh, wow. And that's how it's done, little ones. Isn't this incredible? All the lionesses chasing each other. Obviously, they've got a bit of a spring in their step this morning. The cubs are loving it. Though I think the cubs now finally realize how little they still are, especially when you've got a big lioness charging after you and tackling you, then you realize how little you are in the world. Isn't that beautiful? All those birds starting to wake up. It really feels as though the land has finally been rejuvenated. Of course, this is nothing, not enough rain to stop the drought that we're having. But we're just getting these constant sort of downpours, which is really helping the grass to keep growing. And that's what we need. We don't need a massive downpour of rain, though. That would be nice. But if we could have, like I keep saying, if we could have a little bit of rain once a week or every second week, 10 or 15 mils, 20 mils even better, well, the grass will be back and covering every inch of Djuma and the surrounding areas in no time. Which, of course, will be very interesting to see how the Nkhumas respond to this with the grazing that starts to spread the areas. It means that all the animals are going to start to move out and the big herds are going to break up. And we'll see if they'll still be as successful as they have been over the last few weeks. I'm going to go forward again and just keep up with them. I don't want to put too much distance between us in case we lose them. There we go. Sorry, I'm just turning on the vehicle very quickly. Let's go along the road. Isn't this a wonderful way to start the morning? I absolutely love these lions. Where are you taking us to? Please don't go into the drainage lines today. That's also one of the reasons why I want to give them a bit of space. I don't want to sort of, I suppose, how could you influence them to go somewhere else? It's incredible how we catch these lions in these different moods. One day the lionesses have had enough and don't even want to groom the cubs because they've been such a nuisance the whole day. And then other times, like we're watching this morning, we see them really how playful they are and how they push the little ones around and sort of give it straight back to them. Now, I haven't had a good look at the females yet, so I'm not sure who's here or who's missing. Whether it's Amber Eyes that's not here. Look at that little one going up on the termite mound. Oh, that's going to be very slippery today. Be careful. You are very brave sitting up there. Remember how I've showed you before? I don't know, in case you didn't miss the episode, I went to a termite mound after some rain, and I just went to show everybody how soft the materials become. So I'm wondering if that little cub is perhaps going to slip off of there, because it becomes like a bit like clay when you add a drop of water. Hello, naughty. Are you the king of the castle? No one's coming to play with you. You're the only one sitting up there. And that was a game that I used to play with my brother, my brothers, King of the Castle. I'm going to reposition again because I think that one lioness has gone down into the drainage line. Not good for us, but let's see, perhaps they change course again. Now, good morning, William. I know you mentioned that the lions look like they've got full bellies. They do indeed. And there's been so many buffalo that have been around here. I wonder if it wasn't from one of the calves, so from either that buffalo that they killed two afternoons ago, sort of in the midday, or if it's the one that they finished off just in the open of the dam. Let's just pull off slightly here. Hello, everyone. And it's beautiful and fresh this morning. It's not cold at all. It's about 59 degrees Fahrenheit, which is a nice temperature to start the day, I think. Just want to very quickly get on the radio. I think someone's trying to get hold of me. Just an update. The Nkhuma Pride are now at Central Gari Cutline Junction. It's still just myself here. Copy. I think you must try fuck a jumbo because if they go into the drainage, I think it's going to be tricky. Just letting Aubrey know that I think he should maybe put his foot right down on that pedal and try and get here as quick as he can. Because like James said, we don't know how long we're going to have these Nkhumas for. They could be here, but in the next 30 seconds, they could disappear down into a drainage. And we hope that they don't do that, of course. Something has got the lionesses' attention. They're all looking, listening. Now, one of the lionesses actually went off and down into this drainage system, sort of east of the big pans. So I wonder if she perhaps didn't hear something else down there in this drainage line. I mean, there could be a number of animals around. There could be buffalo, there could be kudu, really anything. Wildebeest, zebra. Let's reposition again, though. Now, I want to count and see how many cubs we've got here. They've been running around. I haven't really had a good look yet. And Nina, as you've said, you haven't seen the floppy little cub, my favorite little girl. I've got her. There she is, sitting just on the other side of the puddle. But we'll get there. Not that one. Wait, move out of the way. There she is, all curled up. What's wrong with you today? You don't look very happy in your jolly self. Maybe she's a little bit cold. My beautiful girl. Yeah, let's see if someone's going to play with her. No, she doesn't seem to be as playful as what she normally is. Maybe she's a bit tired. Remember, she is one of the teddy bear cubs. Maybe she didn't enjoy the rain so much. There we go. You're going to get some sibling love. Unlike us, we had lovely warm beds to keep ourselves nice and dry. But these lions would have had to have tried to find a big tree or something. Oh no, she's waking up now. There she is. Now she's playing. Whee! Isn't that beautiful? No, there she goes. She's perked up again. Look at the one at the tree. I think she's getting some, she's got into trouble. Obviously not listening to the instructions that were given. Just wants to claw the tree. And this lioness is not really allowing for that. No, they're too big to pick up. You can't pick them up anymore. You can see it's funny. I always think those little ones look to be a little bit embarrassed after they get reprimanded or sort of pushed over and told to come and get groomed. And we've got it. I'm going to go forward again though. Seems as though, I think that other lioness has actually come out of the drainage, is one that's just walking out of here. Oh my goodness, look how high they are in the tree. It's like we caught them doing something naughty and now they go, oh my goodness. They really aren't gentle with the cubs anymore. It's like they're teaching them right. This is how you have to behave. You get bowled over and pushed around. I think they're going into the drainage line now, which is not good for us. I'm going to let Aubrey go past very quickly. Aubrey, I think Famba in case they disappear. Okay, we're going to quickly reposition because I think we're going to lose them now. Let's see. They look like they're going to go down into the drainage line, I'm afraid. Very squeaky brakes. This may be the last sort of look we have for the moment. We'll try and keep sticking with them though. Hopefully they go straight down into the drainage and then we'll get them popping out into the sort of fluffy sand. I'm wondering, the cubs are all playing around. It's sort of very hard to try and keep up with them. Perhaps we should go down here. I think if we wait in this little dip, maybe we'll get them coming through. Stop squeaking, brakes. Very rude. Let's go along to the other side and I think we'll get a gap. Here we go. You can see them all actually pop onto the sandy bank here. There's a lioness coming down, all walking around. Hopefully they'll come straight back towards us. One little cub coming down to have a little investigate. What are you looking for? Looks as though it got something in its mouth that it didn't quite like. And off it goes again to play, carry on playing with its siblings. Okay, I'm going to go back again because I think, Dave, I think if we go around we might see them now in this dip. It's very difficult. We're going to have to do quite a bit of this morning. So tough. There they are. Can you see them coming up onto the other side of the bank? We're just trying to get a view. A little bit. Just to try and get the perfect spot. Good. And there they are. And you can see the lovely little drops of water on all the trees surrounding them. Oh. It's so much more impressive, of course, when you see the adults sort of playing with each other, because then you see the sheer force that lions are really capable of. Right, but let's very quickly go across to James, who has got a very wet bird, I'm sure, this morning.
It is a wet bird, everybody. It is a ground scraper thrush, which is not particularly rare. I mean, we do see them pretty often, normally in pairs. And this fellow is probably calling to try and find a mate. But he's got a beautiful call, so I'm just going to shut up for a second. Isn't that nice? It's so pretty. And in the background, a chinspot battus going. Doves. And also some, I think there's a red-eyed dove calling, that's interesting. It's not too common. I'm just going to roll forward, Brian, because I think another one just flew in here. No, it was just a sticker, let's wait here. And the cuckoo in the background. Boop, 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 boop. I always find that the easiest way to discern the African cuckoo's call from the hoopoe, which is boop, 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 is that it sounds like a hoopoe that has had a very heavy night out drinking some very strong ale. So it's just kind of slowed up and lowered down. So the hoopoe goes boop, 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 boop. And the cuckoo goes, Bob, 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 Bob. I'm not going to attempt to make the call of the ground scraper thrush. Brian, would you like to give it a go?
No, thank you.
No, okay. Deep, 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 deep. Such a lovely call. One more, then we'll move. Come on, one more. Very good. That is the ground scraper thrush. Not on the ground, nor scraping at this point. Taylor, we'll try and stay with those lions, but we're going to have very limited off-road ability today, I'm afraid, everyone. Shuluva is on Torchwood, for those of you who know who Shuluva is. One of our leopards from the north that we see, well, seldom, but we do see her sometimes. And this is where we had the reports of wild dogs yesterday, but I'm afraid there were no wild dogs yesterday. Taylor is not with the lions anymore at this stage. They have moved off the road, and I think it's proving quite difficult. If she does find them again, we will head straight back to them, because I think they're being quite playful. But for the moment, let's see what else we can find along here, what discoveries there are as a result of the moisture. The main reason I'm on the southern boundary now, of course, is to check if Karula's come back across, but I don't think she has. Hello, Charlie. You ask a very good question. I'm just trying to stop and get us a view of a bird on a wire, everybody. There we are. That, of course, the lilac-breasted roller enjoying the morning. Charlie, while we look at the lilac-breasted roller, you want to know about the soil here, and you say, it seems to you that when you've seen it dry, it's very kind of sandy and grey, and now that it's wet, you're interested in whether or not there's some kind of darker, more sort of organic soil underneath the top layer here. The short answer to that, Charlie, is no, there isn't. This is granitic-derived soil. It's very, very ancient indeed, which means that it has leached most of its organic material over the millions of years that it has remained unchanged in this area. And so it is fairly nutrient poor, and so your assessment of it as being so is pretty accurate, Charlie. There are parts of the Sabi sand that has black cotton soil, which is it's a gabbro-derived soil, which is kind of a metamorphosized form of granite that forms a much more clay-rich soil. But still, the organic material is not very high in it, but it is slightly more fertile, I suppose, than this granitic-based soil. And the granite-based soils make this kind of sandy soil. It's not very fine, so there's not a lot of clay in it. It doesn't maintain a huge number of nutrients, and so the plants here have to be very specially adapted to living here, and it's why agriculture failed horribly in this area. People did try and grow stuff here. They also tried cattle ranching and that sort of thing. None of it worked, and that's on account of the fact that the soil is really pretty ancient and infertile. And even if you grow vegetables out here, so you know that there are a lot of people living on the western boundaries of the Kruger Park, growing vegetables here is A, difficult, and B, the veggies that you do grow in the soil tend to be fairly nutrient deficient. So it's not a particularly fertile area from an agricultural point of view. It is, of course, filled, however, with life, and that life has adapted to living in these conditions. We'll try and find some form of animal life fairly soon. There's some Franklin's. Hooray, shark. You say that the ground scraper thrush was the 100th bird on your list. I'm pretty sure you'll have this bird on your list. Oh, no, it's gone. It was an arrow-marked babbler sitting quite nicely. We don't often spend much time looking at them because they tend to fly off. might be able to hear them. Let's turn off and roll down the hill. Right, Taylor has found the lions again, everyone. Let's go and find out how they're doing.
So we patiently just waited here and sat until they came out again, because they did disappear for a couple of minutes. But patience is the best thing in the bush, of course. Now, they're actually quite a distance away from us, and they seem to be up and down quite a bit. So we'll just hang tight here. Like I said, today, because of the rain we've had, there's going to be certain roads we're going to avoid, of course, as well as us not doing any off-roading. Now, this is obviously my personal preference. Typically, we don't off-road even after 10 mils of rain, and I suspect we've had a little bit more than that. And it's just, we don't want to sort of ruin the grass, the potential areas where grass is going to be grown, because as soon as you sort of go treading over that, well, that's the end of it. And then you create a new road, and we've got to try and rehabilitate the land. So we'll try and avoid doing any of that. We'll just take a little bit of a distance view. I know it's not the greatest, but at least we can still see the fluffy cubs and the big adults. Now, I wonder where the other lioness has gone. I also hadn't had a proper chance yet to look at who's who in the zoo here. And I wonder where Tinyo and Mfumo have disappeared to. The last time we saw them, it was just Tinyo with the females, and Mfumo was nowhere to be seen. And it's typical, we see them running around and chasing each other, and then of course the little ones settle down after that sort of sugar buzz has finished, and they go and they have a little relax and a little siesta. But because it's nice and cool, I suspect that they're going to be up and down for most of the day. Now, Velma from Michigan, you're wondering if I can tell who the cubs belong to. There's still a little bit of a difference. You can see that the two oldest cubs, obviously now it's unfortunately a bit hard to show you exactly what I'm talking about, but the two oldest cubs are almost 6 months. They're probably 6 months now in November. And, well, they're much larger than the others. They also don't have that very sort of fluffy look that the three little teddy bears still have, though they're losing that as the days go on. And then, of course, the three sort of middle children, well, they don't look as fluffy. They're almost starting to look like the two big cubs. It's quite difficult when you see them sort of separated from each other. The three teddy bears are still the easiest to identify. But when you have the oldest cubs on their own, it can be a bit tricky to try and tell who's who in the zoo, because those middle kids, they're catching up in size. It's incredible how fast they do grow. Now, I can't see all of them. I can just see a couple of them, of course, but I suspect that they're all in the area somewhere. And this is a really wonderful spot to sit, of course. Sit down in the drainage. You can hear anything that's moving along. And I suspect that that's what they're going to do. Because remember, lions are opportunistic feeders, and they don't know when they're going to get their next meal or have an opportunity to take down their next meal. So even though they're just sitting here grooming themselves, just taking a little bit of a rest, if they hear anything, they will definitely respond to it. I'm trying to catch alates that are flying in the vehicle, but I'm not quite quick enough. But I'll get one. By the end of the day, I'll catch one. They've gone very, very quiet now. One of the lionesses came bolting out. Where are you going? Maybe they're going to start moving again. She's carried on going across the drainage line. Hopefully they'll pop back out onto the road again. Now, if you look very, very carefully, you can see sort of looks like strange little things flying around, the lions. Those are the alates that I was telling you about. And there's big ones, there's small ones. I've seen there's at least two different types. We'll try and catch some. Ha ha. No. Darby, open your mouth. Catch it with your mouth. Trying to get Darby to catch them, but he's not cooperating this morning. No, come closer. I get one. No, I'm not quick enough. I'm not like Jackie Chan or anyone like that that's got the biggest and quickest reflexes. They're possibly going to come back towards us. There's a couple of them that are up. Come here. Come here. No. So if you hear crinkling, it's me in my waterproof jacket trying to catch an alate. Okay. No, they're not cooperating. And this is where you just have to be patient, just to wait for them to come out. Now, I've had quite a few of you asking if I'm going to name the little floppy-eared lion. Let's just move forward very quickly. My favorite little girl, and I know that Dale was wondering just that. Floppy ear, I think, is quite fitting. However, my only concern, I'm just going to pull off the road here. Let's see if they're going to come out. I don't think so. Just want Aubrey to get past us. I'll quickly tell you about what I'm going to try and do. So I'm a little bit uncertain because in the southern pride, so this pride that lives down in the south of the Sabi Sand, you can see them moving along there. Now, there's a lion called Mandlev, and she too has a floppy ear. And her name is either Floppy Ear or Mandlev, which means ear. So I'm a little bit uncertain if I want to just take that name. Of course, it's very fitting. But what do you think? Do you think it matters if there's two lions that have sort of the same name? She's a very old girl. She's probably right at the end of her lifespan now. She's about 15 years old or so. So maybe she could be the new Mandlev coming up. But let me know your thoughts. What do you think? Mandlev, Floppy Ear? I think we need to have a little discussion about this. But James has got something with spots.
Ah, everybody, the morning has turned out wonderful. We came past this area, we saw nothing, we went into the drainage line, and then we heard the call of those guinea fowl. You can hear them, they're very upset. They don't like Karula or Xongile or Hosana. Negative, I can't see any lions. Look how cross those guinea fowl are. Now look at this, because we can see them standing together. Look at the size of Hosana, that's him in the middle, compared with his little sister and his mum. Isn't this fantastic? Oh wow. And look, he's got stocky. Look at the size of his little feet. And the guinea fowl are chasing them down the road, saying, go away, go away, go away. Look. Oh, this is too precious. See Karula there calling the cub. I don't know if you noticed that, everyone. But they are all over the place, these guinea fowl. And Karula was just telling Xongile, she called her, leave them alone, let's carry on. And they've got their tails curled up in that kind of surrender. Look at the little male going now. And then he's decided, no, his mother wants him to come along. I wonder if she hasn't killed something else somewhere around here. Now, they are still south of the boundary, I'm afraid, everybody. But they're very slightly to the south, and it looks like they might come north. I'm just going to reverse slightly. Please come north. Oh, wow, this is going to be too special. Look at that, everyone. She's coming closer to us, calling the little cubs. Good morning, Mom. I think in this light, everyone, in this kind of environment, only a leopard looks this beautiful. Its colors really do stand out stunningly. Here comes little Hosana. Guinea fowl, ongoing and ballistic. They're going north into Djuma, everybody. This is awesome. Okay, let me turn. I'm also just going to call this in. Stations located Karula and Cubs. They are at the junction Gowrie Main and the Mulwati. They're going east at the moment, but seem to be about to turn north. Keep our distance. Those two little cubs from very early on have been nervous of moving cars when they've been moving, so we'll just keep our distance. Well, the morning has turned out rather well. I didn't think we were going to see these chaps. Look, 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 look. That was Xongile coming to say hello to Mum. Hosana walking in a very stately fashion to the left. Or was that him? No, that was Hosana, I think. Xongile is off to the left. Aren't they perfect little leopards? They are so cool. That's Hosana on the right, Her Majesty in the middle, and Shongas on the left. Right, now James, you say you've seen guinea fowl before and it's helped give you a perspective of the size of the cubs. Yes, I suppose it is a little bit difficult sometimes. I'm going to stop here. So Karula's this probably about, 40, 45 kilos or so, which is almost 100 pounds. And she stands at the shoulder, I guess about the height of sort of ridgeback. If you can imagine a ridgeback dog. Look at the little ones moving now. There's about to be a great attack from the left. There we are. And the Xongile, I would say, is now the size of a... He's almost sort of Labrador-sized. And Hosana, at least... Hosana's about Labrador-sized, and Xongile, who's now at the back there, is, well, substantially smaller. You can see that. Oh, this is so pretty. Look at the little tail going. That is so cool. Well, nobody's coming to the sighting. Anyway, we won't complain about that. What we don't want, of course, is for them to stay on this road, because we're between two areas of the reserve, which means that we can have a great vehicle mass up in seconds. Now, don't go south. You've come from the south. There's another vehicle there.
Thanks for opening up.
Now, because they've come from the south, I think that they are probably going to go north. Unless they're just moving. I'm sure Karula's killed something, though. She's going to be stalked from the right. She's about to be attacked. There we go. What an attack it was. And now she's turning south again. She's looked up at the vultures on the left there, and then she kind of thought better of carrying on that direction. She's probably, much like human beings, I suppose, thinking there might be some kind of kill there. Just, Brian, get onto the cub here. Look at the cub. So cool. Yes, Shark, you're absolutely correct. Today is their 9-month birthday. They're 9 months old today. Karula was 12 in March, and these chaps are now 9 months old. And they're going south, which makes me very sad. And it's those vultures that have driven them south here. They've decided that they want to move away because those vultures will attract other predators, like lions. Now, whether they don't just, they might just skirt the vultures, I suppose, and then come north. Okay, let's carry on going so we can get a view. So to the north of us is left. The vultures are over there. And what we hope they're going to do is just go around like that. They're still there. And maybe then head up north. This is Ephraim from Cheetah Plains. Aye. Ninjan. Okay. Ephraim says, everyone, that there are tracks coming across here, so he thinks she has killed inside Djuma. There she goes. She's just waiting. Yeah, that's exactly what she was doing. She was just skirting the vultures. Oh, that's fantastic. We'll just give them a little bit of space. And the other little cub will be coming out. This guinea fowl is still shouting. I think they would be shouting at anything else. This is maybe a hyena trailing these cubs and their mum. See, she stopped to call Xongile now. Watch her mouth. Now, you see here we have this great vehicle conflagration. There's one coming from the south. Anyway, let's carry on. I think she's going to go north, which means we should be able to escape too much vehicle attention. I'm just going to keep the distance because I don't know where Xongile is. She's in, I think, to the right-hand side here somewhere. There she is. We can see her now. You can just see her trotting on the right-hand side of your picture. Interesting, I thought she was bolder at the beginning of life, but as he gets a bit bigger, so he's starting to become more and more bold. And this, of course, is where she kept them after they were born for a long time. In the culvert, just to where we are now. She's just going to drink here. I'm just going to move slightly forward. Leopardess is just in the bushes there. She's having a drink. Let me move around the other side there. There she's moving now. I'm going to just get off this road, everyone. The cubs have gone off to the right-hand side there. They're down in there. There. Look. There's little Xongile, at least the Hosana. And they were in that culvert. They lived in that culvert for, I don't know, almost a month, I think. Right, let's see if she hasn't got a kill somewhere close by here. Good, she's going north onto Djuma, which is excellent news. There they go, playing along. The Queen of Djuma has sent through a Twitter a tweet, which is interesting because I don't know how she's managed to use her phone while she's been sort of walking with the cubs. But the Queen of Djuma says she doesn't think that the guinea fowl are that these guys are going to be on the guinea fowl's Christmas card list this year. No, I'm pretty sure they won't. Those guinea fowl were deeply unimpressed. Now, I wonder if she's killed again. I suspect whatever she killed yesterday was probably stolen from her as well. As the big impala she killed the day before was. Get my head out of the way. Orbs, she's on the fire break, still heading east, parallel with Gari Main. Yeah, I'll keep you posted. I think your best approach at this stage is going to be Chitikatlan. I wonder if she hasn't put a kill in Torchwood. That is going to be a little irritating. We're quite close to the eastern boundary now, everybody. Little leopard right in front of us there. There we are. It's coming into view, and the other one coming from the right-hand side. Xongile, at least Hosana, is full of joy today. He is leaping around the place. Around about now, I'm starting to look into the trees to see if there aren't perhaps some dangling antelope legs. Go ahead.
James and I come in there as well.
Yeah, if Lex, I think best approach at this stage is going to be Cheetah Cutline. I'll keep you posted. There are two Chitwa vehicles kind of in the sighting, but they're quite a long way away in the on Gari Main, and we're now moving away from Gari Main.
Okay, thank you. I'm still a little way away, so if somebody wants
look
to go ahead
that.
Me, that's
beautiful.
Fine, but I'm heading that way now.
That's Lex just trying to come into the sighting. Just going to move forward. It seems to me like she's left something around here. She's not moving with any purpose anymore. Either that or she's just smelt something. Oh, now she's playing with the cubs. They're down in the drainage now. There they go.
Just Kwazedi Junction, but it's still
Oh dear, why have you gone there, Karula? That is very inconvenient of her to have done that. We'll try and carry on following. We may have to turn around and go back around. Very convenient crossing point right here. That's very nice, isn't it, Brian? She knew, of course, that the road wasn't continuing. M. Ruth, you say, what would happen if they crossed paths with the Nkhumas? Horrible things would happen, I'm afraid. Very horrible things indeed would happen. The Nkhumas would almost certainly kill them, exactly as the Styx Pride killed one of Tundi's cubs, I think 2 days ago. So that would be a disaster. They are, at this stage, quite far away from each other, probably about a mile and a half or so. Isn't this just wonderful? Don't you think their colour is amazing in this light? Oh, look. They are the one animal, I think, that gets away with this poor light. The rest tend to look a little bit drab, and I'm sure if you were to compare the colour of these animals with the... She's got the kill. Where do you see it, Brian? Oh, yes, look, there it is. Ha, ha, ha. Okay, I'm just going to have to announce this. I don't think we're going to be able to be here for quite as long as I wanted, because obviously those other two vehicles are well entitled to be here. And so when Aubrey comes, we'll move out. Aubrey and Lex, they have got a small kill. I can't see exactly what it is. Between the firebreak and the road, about, I don't know, probably about 250 meters to the west of Cheetah Cutline Junction, Gowrie Main. So best approach is Gowrie Main. I'll move out as soon as one of you gets here.
Copy. Thanks, James.
Isn't that fantastic? What is that? What do you it looks like a young kudu. What do you think, Brian? Maybe? You think it's a daker? Oh dear. Oh. Alright, final control agrees with Brian that it's a young diker. I'm just going to move around here. It is a diker. Thank you, everybody. Well done. Not, in fact, a young kudu. She says she ate a little bit. She killed this thing, ate a little bit, then went back to fetch her cubs. Wowee. What a morning we've had. There's a millipede there, Brian. You see that? How delicious. Just tilt slightly down. There we go. Wonderful. That's really vile. And Karula at this stage not vaguely interested in eating. And the very sensible daughter has gone straight to where there's meat. The son, filled with his maturing hormones, is pretending to kill the diker again. As opposed to eating, he's playing with his food, you see. is just wonderful. He looked up because there was a sort of snapping of branches behind. Oh, this is fantastic. He's so excited. He's so exuberant. That was Lex saying there's a male lion on Biffle's Hook. I think it's dead, Hosana. I don't think there's any further need for you to try and kill it. That is a little gruesome. I'm sorry if this is a little bit gruesome for some of you. Yes, Shamsun, good point. This is, I think, probably also the first time I've ever seen a cub, the cubs sharing a kill before. And they've certainly eaten separately on the same kill. But this is the first time I've seen them feeding together, although what Hosana's doing can hardly be described as feeding. He's re-killing his prey. I cannot believe how big he's got. Hey, Brian? He's a substantial animal now. Look at the claws. Look at that thing. Ooh, you wouldn't want to be raked by that. An ex-ranger, I agree completely. A mother like Karula, extremely experienced, knows how to raise a youngster. You say she will not give them pudding if he continues to play with his food. I agree completely, and I've no doubt she's telling him that very thing. He will not be allowed any sour plum fruit, or indeed the offal from inside the carcass if he continues to play with his food. What a privilege. So we'll just sit here, everybody, until Aubrey arrives, and he'll arrive fairly soon, I imagine, and then we'll move out. Because we've had a wonderful view, and now Mum's getting involved. There she is, giving him a good clean. Very important that she looks after their cleanliness and hygiene. And Hosana has now ruined the fun for everybody by moving the kill around the tree, which means for us, we can go and look. But unfortunately, the people watching on the road from Chitwa Chitwa are not going to be allowed to. Now, he's sitting there and he's actually hissing. He's becoming protective over his kill. Look at her, isn't she wonderful? Being affectionate with her daughter. And of course, it won't be too long, everybody, before before Xongile goes independent. And Jennifer, you say it's very funny to watch them sort of pretend and learn. Jennifer, it is funny and it's interesting, but there's not... what he's doing there is entirely instinctual. It's not a case of her teaching him. And I know that there have been documentaries where it seems as if a leopard is teaching their cubs. I've really yet to see the same amount of teaching that goes on with cheetah. They are largely instinctual killers, these leopards. Mm. Xongile has now had enough of being cleaned, and she's going to go and sulk because her brother has moved the kill. I'm just going to call Aubrey. Go ahead, Orbs. Orbs, just come along, Gari Main. You'll get us. We're 200 meters from there. As soon as I've got your audio, I'll move out. Yeah, that's the Chitwa guys. Okay, I'm going to move out for you, Orbs. I'll come on to Gari Main. Okay, everybody, I'm afraid that's going to be it for us today. Not, obviously, for our safari, but for this sighting. So we're going to head out of here, and we'll come back, of course, this afternoon, and hopefully she'll still have this kill, and hopefully it'll be in a tree. Marvellous. Wasn't that fun, Brian?
That was.
Yes. On we go. Gosh, we might actually come back before the end of the drive. I don't think the view is going to be very good for these chaps for very long. Nkhuma, itavonana. Kui. Male chita plane. Okay, itafamba Nkhuma. Right, we're out of the sighting. Not sure where Aubrey is. He's just up here, I think. Now, that fellow said that there was some cheetah on cheetah plains, and it might be worth us going there. We'll see. There's Aubrey. And he will see them. I don't think we need to tell him.
Sorry, again,
Jim. Orbs, I'm out of that sighting, so go for it. Right. I think let's try and head towards Cheetah Plains once we've had a very nice look at this large herd of impala and waterbuck. Gorgeous. Lovely, lovely call of the crested barbet in the background. It should be sitting on Byron's windowsill, waking him up, of course. Oh, they just love this new grass. And we were chatting yesterday about them being on an ecotone, which is a kind of a region where two vegetation types join, and that's exactly what they're doing here again. They've come off the ridge crest and they're heading down towards the drainage, and so they're on that kind of seep line area where a very specific suite of grasses grows, and that's what they're looking for, far more than they're looking for water to escape from predators in. And while they do certainly do that, sometimes I've never seen them do it. And just about all water sources will have a waterbuck bull that set up his territory there. The vast majority of them don't spend any time around water. They spend their time in these ecotone regions grazing. That is my waterbuck fact for the week, Brian.
Wonderful.
Yes, I think so. Impala, of course, just lurk in the background everywhere. What makes them so successful? And the other thing that I did see today, Brian and I were, in fact, there may be two just up ahead. Brian and I were driving around when Taylor found the lions, and we found one impala ram that was not yet a year old, but he should have been a year old. In other words, he was probably one of those February lambs and has not quite reached a year. So he's what we call in Afrikaans a laat lammetjie, which means a late lamb, basically. comes from that second breeding season that the Impala have in September. Yeah, they're loving, very selectively picking specific grass species. Marvellous. On we go. Morning, Gloria. You're wondering if the cat sightings can get any better. Well, you say if we add cheetah to the mix, maybe. Yes. Well, look, we're going to head across to Cheetah Plains. We'll see what we can find there. I suspect that there is a giant amount of activity there right now, so we may or may not be lucky. But we might be. Let's go and see. I have no communications with them from this distance, though, so I can't tell what's happening. In the meantime, we're now basically going to cross out of the signal area until we get to Cheetah Plains. Let's head across to Tayla and find out what's happening with her.
Not much, unfortunately. A couple of birds here and there, ones that want to stick around for long enough. And of course, lots and lots and lots and lots of impala. But we're coming up to Biffles Hook Dam. Now I want to have a little look and see if there's perhaps anything else around. And wouldn't it be nice to see how much water is now in the dam? We'll be able to find out in just a moment. We're just approaching now. Wow, look how full it is. Let's park at the perfect spot. Gonna go right to the edge so we get a good view. How's that, David? There we go. Now, I think that this dam looks much more fuller than what it was, especially the way that it goes sort of down and behind us to the right. Now, I know, William, you were wondering exactly that. You were actually commenting today if there is any notice. I think there is. I think the pan at the back will probably try and take another little view. I think that it is also filled up quite nicely. Let's go around, though. Let's see if we can have another little look and look from the other side and perhaps, well, if Rusty goes into reverse. Let's go see. I think so, though. And like I said, it was such nice rain that we had yesterday. You know, it's one thing having those downpours, but then you just cause so much erosion, whereas these lovely soaking rains, and I hope we have more of it today, not now, after 8 o'clock it can rain and then it must stop at 3 o'clock. And then I think that it's definitely much fuller. Let's go up a little bit further ahead so we can sort of compare, but I mean, you can sort of just see now that there's quite a bit more. Let's look here. Here we go. What do you think? I think that they've definitely filled up quite a bit. They started to dry out very, very quickly at one point. Just when we saw those saddle-billed stalks, we already noticed, of course, that the water was flowing dry. I've just spotted our favorite pair of Egyptian geese. There they are. We can always count on them to be at Biffles Hook Dam, which is quite nice. It looks like they're going to go in for a little wade in the water. Are you going to go for a wade or are you going to go for a swim? Let's have a look. No, it seems as though Mrs. Egyptian Goose, the one that's drinking water. Now, typically the male is much bigger than the female. You can see here the male is the one on the left. And quite vocal as well. And quite typical of the Egyptian geese as well. They're very territorial. So you often hear the males sort of, as they go along their day, whether they're feeding or whether they're swimming around, they will make that noise. Just letting everybody know that this area is indeed occupied. And he's staying hot on the heels of his mate. He's not leaving her side at all. But you can clearly see the size difference there. He's much larger than her. And sometimes it's the opposite. I know for African fish eagles, for example, it's actually the female that's bigger than the male. Oh, and look who we've got running along here. Is this a three-banded plover? By some, can you see it? My goodness, it's so quick. There he is. Hello, we have indeed got a little three-banded plover. Now, they are really tiny little birds. I reckon if you had to take your fist for a fully grown man and you bunch your fist up, that's probably the size of their body and their head. And then you'll just have to add maybe two fingers behind and then you'll get the entire size of that bird. They're little things. But how quick is it going? Now they're looking for little insects that are sort of moving around on the surface of the mud and even sometimes will peck them straight off the surface of the water. But where's your friend? You don't have a mate. Just seems to be that little one. Off it goes. Isn't that lovely? Lovely birds today, but let's carry on. Now, earlier when we were with the lions, unfortunately they disappeared into the bushes, but perhaps we'll make our way back around that side and see if they've popped out. I'll have a chat on the radio and see if we can't get hold of anyone. But we were having a discussion about what we're going to call, of course, that little one. Now, I'm wondering what everyone's opinion is. It's quite nice to hear what everybody thinks. Remember I said there's already a floppy ear, a mandlev, down in the south of the southern sector of the sand. I wonder if it's okay. I like the name and I think it's suited because that's exactly what she is. She's got a floppy ear to her. But I don't particularly have a problem with it. I quite like it. But we will see. I think we need to just, we need to see how she goes. She's looking good though, and she's looking strong. I don't think it seems to be getting too worse just yet. But we'll have a look. We'll have to wait until she dries out, and then we'll have another look at her. But let's see what's up around and down this way. Now, it also sounded like what I heard on the radio, that one of the Birminghams are in Biffle's Hook. I'm not sure which one. They didn't really specify. So I wonder if he's perhaps going to come back, or maybe he was just out doing a territorial patrol, whichever one of the males it was. Right, let's see if there's anyone with the lions still. Is there any mobile with the Nkhuma pride? Just confirm where did you leave them, their last position? Copy, thank you. I'd like to move into that area again. There you go. So I think that's what we're going to do, is we're probably going to head back around and see if we can get a view of the Nkhumas. Though it sounds like everybody has actually left them because they seem to have disappeared and we are restricted. Oh, look at this big hippo. You can see him coming out of this mud wallow. Sorry, I apologize. I am parked slightly to the side. We're on one of the fire breaks. Isn't he beautiful? I wonder if this is Henry. Let's see if he's got a scar on his back. I can't see anything just yet. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's somebody else. But he is a beautiful big hippopotamus. Sorry, boy. I didn't mean to disturb you in your little mud jacuzzi. You know that there's a dam full of water behind us with no hippos. I wonder, probably he doesn't know that just yet. I'm going to give him a bit of space. I think he'll probably go down into the drainage line. Well, hopefully he actually goes back into his mud wallow, and well, then we will go back and we'll go a different way around. But he's giving us the evil stare at the moment. It's okay, mister. Look at your muddy feet. And I love their feet. They're such funny looking things for such a large animal. And they always seem to move so slowly as well when they're walking. We all know that hippos can reach quite a speed. They can run well over 30 kilometers an hour. And if you've seen a hippo charging before, my goodness, it's quite scary. The sound that you hear when they come running towards you, and they also open and close their mouth, which can be quite intimidating. We used to see it a lot in Zambia when there'd be another male perhaps approaching the water, and then the big territorial bull would come charging out to try and intimidate that youngster. Let's go down a little bit further. I'm hoping that once we go past him, though, he'll just go back into his wallow, so we won't disturb him for too much, but I think we'll have another look. Oh, Rusty, why do you have to have squeaky brakes now? You can see he's disappearing, though. Off he goes. Just see, it looks like a big rock moving away. Here he is. I wonder if he is also going to perhaps take a bit of an advantage or sort of time out in the bush today, because it's nice and cool. It's overcast. It's really a great day to go and have a little snack and catch up on some grazing that they've probably been missing over the last few months. But there he goes. And I think we shall leave him at that and not disturb him for too much longer. Right, let's go up this way. We're going to go back down Gari Cutline. And then we'll head into the little dip and see if the Nkhumas are around. It looked as though at one point, though, they were smelling something. You could see they were very keen. Their ears were pricked. They were definitely listening. So I wonder what was down in that drainage line. As we went carried on, though, David and I did smell something that smelled quite vile. I'm not sure if it was another buffalo that had unfortunately passed on, or maybe it could have been something else. I'm not sure, though. See any nice birds around? Let's have a look. Oh, we've got some beautiful kudu down in the distance. Let's see if we can get a view. Now, with all the termites that are around, I think we're going to see a lot of activity and unusual activity. And James was wondering just that, is, are we going to see any sort of unusual activity of the nocturnal creatures staying out a little bit longer than what they normally would to take advantage of the allies? I think so. I reckon we're going to maybe see a couple of owls out, and things like the civets and stuff, probably early morning, maybe a bit longer out in the morning. I don't know if we would see them out now, though. That would be very unusual. But it is also very overcast and it's nice and cool. So there's definitely a possibility, and we can't rule it out, of course. Look at those two. They're staring at us. Looks like a young male and a female. Could you? You see them there? It's a whole family of kudu. Now, he doesn't look particularly large, that male. He's probably only a couple of years old. You can see his horns. He's really only just got one turn in his horns. And I'm sure that they're very happy at the moment with all this lovely new green leaves, a bit of moisture on the leaves. See, something like a kudu doesn't have to drink every day, because the leaves do contain quite a bit of water, especially now at the moment. But on very hot days, like all the other animals, they won't turn a drink down. And this is quite nice as well. You can sort of see the browsing level of the kudu. And something that I absolutely loved when I was in Zambia was there were these beautiful Natal mahogany trees. Now, I haven't seen too many around here, but they are beautiful trees. I suppose they could almost look like a kagilia tree. You know, the sausage tree that Steph absolutely loves to show you? A little bit similar to that. But if I do find one, I'll show you a mahogany. I haven't seen any just yet, though. Now, there was this massive open plain. I don't know if I've told this story before. It's one of my favorite stories. It almost looked as though somebody had come around and planted all these mahogany trees, hundreds of them. There were some of them were perfectly in a row, otherwise the others were sort of all spread out. And they all looked perfectly manicured as well. And that's thanks to the kudu, who would go and stand underneath the mahoganies, which provide a lovely amount of shade. And in the summer months in Zambia, it gets very, very hot. Almost every day is in excess of 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So they would stand under there, and then of course they would eat it. So the sort of browsing level that you would see in all these trees that made them look perfectly manicured was about 1.8 meters off of the ground. It was lovely. It was perfect for a tree to go and sit underneath a tree like that and have a picnic. Now I'm still trying to catch L8s, but I haven't been successful just yet. Now, I'm watching this kudu as he's eating his breakfast, and I know Paula was wondering this morning, do kudu also eat meat, or is it just the leaves that they feed on? So Paula, the antelope species, so the kudu, the impala, the bushbuck, the nyala, they all just eat a variety of either leaves or grass, or sometimes even both, and a couple of bits of fruit. And they don't need to eat meat at all because they get all the protein and carbohydrates they need from the various plants around here. So it's really just the lions, of course, the leopards, the hyenas, and all the other little wonderful creatures that we see, as well as quite a few bird species that will feed on the meat. But the antelope, they leave it alone, except there's one, which I didn't want to believe until I see it for my own eyes, which is a common dacre. So Paula, that's a little grey antelope that we see running around here. It's quite small, and they're quite difficult to show as well on camera. They don't like the vehicles, and they also live on their own, so they're quite shy and secretive. And they actually will catch mice and rats and little birds, like sort of chicks of birds, and they will eat them. And I've seen this a couple of times, and it's quite spectacular when you come around the corner and there's a common dacre, and it looks like it's got a piece of spaghetti in its mouth dangling from it, and it's not a spaghetti, and its mouth is full, and it's normally the end of a mouse's tail. How amazing is that? That they're able to utilize small rodents like that. Right, let's see if James has arrived at Cheetah Plains.
We have indeed arrived on Cheetah Plains, everybody, where we found Andrew, and we said, Andrew, we heard there were cheetah here. He said, huh? So I'm not sure exactly what was going on there. Either Andrew's had his radio off most of the morning, or we were sold down the river. Anyway, we'll see if we can find a cheetah regardless. We might also find Quarantine, Shivambalani, Inkanyeni. I'd like to see Inkanyeni and find out how her leg is after Quarantine gave it a bit of a bashing. Right. The first place we're going to go, of course, Brian, is?
Cheetah Plains Pools.
No, Trifecta Pans. Yes. Trifecta Waters.
Three in a row lady.
Three in a row lady pans. That's the one. I think, which is somewhere around here. Now, the rain, of course, affects many things, and it does affect the ground and makes some areas muddier, and it makes some areas, just a little more sloshy. And Tammy, you're wondering if it affects the predators and makes it more difficult for them to kill. Tammy, I don't believe that it does make it any more difficult for them to kill or any easier for them to kill. Their prey does slip. Yes, I think that was your question. The prey does slip. But so do the lions. Of course, so do the predators. They also slip. So I don't think it's necessarily any easier or harder to kill. There was a little diker on top of that termite mound, just surveying the scene. There are two of them there. Well, this is quite nice. I'll tell you why if we get a view of them. Because I think what you can see there, they're still there and they're gone. The female was much bigger than the male, noticeably bigger. And that is the case with dikers, one of the few mammals where the female is bigger than the male. On average. Of course, there are some humans The female is bigger than the male. I have met women that are larger than I. I think the closer you get to humans in the primate world, the more that happens. Brian, I'm not entirely sure that I haven't gone off-piste somewhere. Louise, we're now starting to lose communications, I'm afraid. Aaron, you're in New Zealand, of course, and you're wondering about the jackals, and maybe we'll see them. Yes, we could see the jackals. It would be wonderful to see them. I'm going to just put my phone on. Well, it is on. Lou, I think we're heading to phone territory at this stage. Good signal on the phone. Yes, I've still got you on the radio for now. See what's along here. I don't think I took the road that I wanted to. Don't worry, we're not trespassing. We're still on Cheetah Plains. But the universe has led us here, Brian. Who knows what will be on this road or what won't. This is where I last saw Nkhanyeni. There is our tower. Having a slight panic attack. Let me just load the map. It all looks rather different, you see, in the when there's cloud. Yes, we're fine. That's where I thought we were. Phew. Right. Three ladies pan up ahead. Is anybody able to tell me why it is that around the world you will find places called the following? Seven Oaks, there's always somewhere called Seven Oaks. There's always somewhere called Three Sisters. Never really understood either. Why do oaks grow in sevens? And do they indeed grow in sisters, at least in sevens? And do sisters always come in threes? Right, let's see if quarantine's in his favourite marula tree, which I've never seen him in. Therefore, I don't believe it's his favourite marula tree. No, he's not there. Brian, do you hear that rather disturbing knocking noise coming from the engine? What do you think it is? Oh, well. If the engine drops out, we'll have to get Connor Roadside Assist to come and fetch us. Nothing drinking at Trifecta Pans. Now, they'll stop pumping these pans now as the water comes. Oh, there's something quite macabre. Isn't it macabre, Brian? That is the dead buffalo, everybody, that we think died of being stuck here. And nothing has come to eat it, except, of course, the maggots. That white there, everyone, is a seething mass of maggots. Goodness, that is disgusting, is it not, Brian? And that, the regal carrion fly. Those blue things with the orange eyes. And there's the children of the regal carrion fly. Ugh. I mean, that is quite something. I can't believe there are no birds or anything like that that want to eat those maggots. Well, who can blame them? I wouldn't want to eat them either, would you, Brian? No. Crawling, seething mass. If you are a sensitive viewer, I apologize for the slightly disgusting nature of this sighting. They're not exactly sharing their food with great relish, are they, Brian? It looks like they're having a bit of a fight. How much would I have to pay you to put your hand in that, Brian?
Not much.
Not much?
I think
would you? Good grief.
Wouldn't you?
Oh, I think... Sensation? For some, imagine the sensation. Yes, imagine the sensation. It would be quite something. Louise says, do it, do it. Louise, we would. There are two reasons we won't, though. You know, there's a lot of mud here, and we don't want to get muddy shoes. That's the main reason. No. We, too, don't want to end up like that buffalo. There we are. That's quite enough of that. That's disgusting. Mm. 3 in a row, Pan never disappoints, Brian. Just going to turn the radio up because I think there is something going on here. Lara, you're in somewhere called Patumba. I have no idea where in the world that is. But you say there are mountains there called Three Sisters. Of course there are. There's a place in the Eastern Cape that's called Three Sisters. There's a place in the Karoo that's called Three Sisters. There's definitely the smell of carrion in the air. Anyway, we'll see if we can find what's making the smell. In the meanwhile, I think Taylor is making her way back towards the lines. Let's find out how that's going.
Right, now, we're almost where these lions were left, but of course we saw they were on the move this morning. So I don't know if they would have stayed put for too long. And, well, we've got road restrictions as to what roads we can drive on. So we can't go onto Twin Dams, unfortunately. So I'm just having a quick look down here to see if we can maybe find anything. But nothing just yet. And I'm going quite slowly because I want to see if I can pick up on their footprints or anything like that. No, not lion tracks. We'll just go slowly. Ah, there's the culprits, the zebra footprints that I was looking at. They're just in over here. Hi, zebbies. Let's see if we can get a nice look. I'm going to try and sneak up to them. Always got to be sneaky with the zebras. Why do they always disappear? All the time. They are there hiding behind the bushes. Stop moving, zebra. There they go. There's lots of zebra bums over there. Now they seem very relaxed, and this seems to be the direction that the lions were walking in. We haven't seen anything coming out though on this little road, and it seems as though the zebra are quite relaxed. Normally the zebra are very vigilant, and I didn't even hear any alarm calls, but I think that they've come from the eastern side of the road and they seem to be going north now. But you can see they don't look perturbed at all. Also, I'm just listening as we're driving. It's quite nice to just stop and listen because those little cubs make quite a bit of noise. Oh, I'm being summoned. Standing by. A negative, go with the location. Oh, this is exciting. Very nice. I think I'm gonna make my way around there. I think these Nkhumas are either in this block or in the drainage somewhere, and I don't wanna off-road here. I'm gonna come around and join you. Right, change your plan. It seems as though that male lion that was in Biffle's hook has now come south, and he seems to have come along around Hippo Pools Road, somewhere around there. So let's start making our way down that side. We're going to jump back onto Central again, which is very good news for us. It'd be nice to see a mail line, I think, this morning. So we'll head on over down there. It's going to take us a little bit of time to get there, but we'll try and do it as sort of quick as we can. Wonderful. So Lex has just said we must go along Gwari Pan. I'll copy, thank you very much. I'll be there shortly. Let's do that then. Whee, around we go. So you'll just have to bear with us as we drive along. But hopefully he doesn't go east. Otherwise that's going to be very tricky. If he crosses Cheetah Cut Line, we'll be in a little bit of trouble. Now I'm not sure which mail line it is. Maybe it's not even a Birmingham at all. No, I'm sure it's a Birmingham. But it'll probably be either Tinyo or Mfumo. Those are the ones we seem to be seeing all the time. And I think that's what's happened, is whoever is off mating with one of the Nkhuma lionesses, I think the other one obviously went off on a territorial patrol. Now I wonder what's going on Cheetah Plains and what James is up to this morning. I hope he does manage to come across some cheetah or anything like that if they are around, or even an ostrich. I'd be quite excited to see an ostrich, in fact. I'm also just scanning as we're going along for anything particularly interesting, or up we go. A little bit slippery here, but nothing that Rusty can't handle. Now this is the area, it smells like something has died. It's quite terrible. Well, oh, it's very foul. We took a very slow drive around here, but we couldn't see anything, so it must be much further off into the thicket. I'm going under my jacket for this. David,
yes.
Did you enjoy that smell?
It was great.
David said it was great, and he can't wait for breakfast now. I'm not a fan, of course, of these smells. No! Darn it! I was hoping that no one was going to bring up the vervet monkey thing. Oh no, James was wondering if I've been working on my vervet monkey call. Now, I was supposed to do that yesterday, that was my homework, and I didn't, unfortunately, get an opportunity to. I'm too scared to do one now because it's really bad and I'm terrible at it. But this afternoon, however, I promise I will do a vervet monkey call. I promise, but this morning I just cannot face the embarrassment, unfortunately. No. Louise says that we should do a before and after and on how I improve on my vervet monkey call. Not happening, Louise. Unless we can get the lovely ladies who are in final control, unless they want to do a vervet monkey call for us as well, I think it's only fair. They get to sit and laugh at us all the time and hide behind the camera. Now, I really need to work on it. Like, normally I don't mind being laughed at, but this is just such a poor attempt considering how long I've actually been in the bush for. I'm probably going to be mocked for the rest of my life. So I'm going to have to, unfortunately, decline your offer, Louise, and we shall go tomorrow. Let's have a very quick look at this giraffe, which we've just come across, but it's going to be a very brief little visit, as I'm worried that this lion is going to cross out of our property, and I would love to have a little look at him before he decides to disappear. And of course, again, we've got a lovely male, which I've said time and time again, we're seeing plenty of at the moment. Where are all the girls at, mister? Now, he doesn't seem to be particularly old. He doesn't look, he almost looks like he's a dwarf giraffe, don't you think? He doesn't look too tall, but he's got lovely dark coloration. Look at him. African pygmy giraffe. He's got a couple of sort of marks on his neck. Let's have a look at his face. His face doesn't look too calcified just yet. Can you see that? Those big calcifications are just starting to develop on top of his head. And normally the older they get, the sort of the uglier they start to look. Though you're still beautiful, giraffe. But he doesn't look very tall. He's probably only about 4 meters tall. So unless he's just got really good genes and he's got this beautiful dark colouring to him. Oh, he's very young. Like I said, he doesn't look very battered up. But it does look funny. Hang on, let me just quickly chat to Lex. Standing by. We're going to have to keep moving. Ooh. Right. I think we're going to have to go across to James. I need to race around and try and get this lion.
Racing to get to a lion? Well, that lion must be doing something other than lurking on its bottom. Well, we're sitting here, of course, with the greatest bum in Africa. And that, of course, is the zebra. The virtual zebra. Very beautiful bottoms, aren't they, Brian?
They are.
Yes. Excellent tails. In the background, the Steerling's wren warbler is calling. Please ask Byron to make the call for you when he's on drive this afternoon. You will not be disappointed. It goes tick-a-tick, tick-a-tick. Louise has very kindly made a note to herself, everyone, so that she may ask Byron this afternoon to make the call, which, of course, will be funny for her and you, and indeed him, because he's such a good sport about it. I suppose we should also ask Taylor to make the same call, because it would only be fair. Don't you think, Brian?
Yeah.
Yes. Right, we're not far from Cheetah Plains Pan. So let's just drive along there into the clearing. There we are. Aaron, New Zealand, you say near where you are there's a beach called the Three Sisters and the Elephant. Well, that's unusual. I'm not sure that, I don't think elephants ever existed in New Zealand, but I guess it was just a quirk of naming, but the Three Sisters, there you are. New Zealand, we've had at, what was that strange place called? Patumba. I'd love to know where Patumba is. Please tell us where Patumba is. Katumba. There's Three Sisters there, at least five or six of them in South Africa. There we go. Three Sisters Mountain Range in Oregon. Thank you for that starry night. I mean, it's amazing. I guess and a place called Sisters. Who were the original Three Sisters? I'm sure I should know that. I think the belt stars of Orion are often called the Three Sisters, but they weren't, that's not their original name. Ah, thank you, Book Diva. Well, with a name like Book Diva, why are we surprised that you've given us the answer? Faith, Hope, and Charity are the Three Sisters. I feel like I did know that at one stage of my life. I'd love to know in what context Faith, Hope, and Charity are the Three Sisters. Thank you for that, Book Diva. Here is Cheetah Plains Mud Wallow. Isn't it beautiful, Brian?
Amazing.
It is truly a body of water to rival that of Lake Michigan. Aha. Betty Sleep, you say the Three Sisters were from a story where three sisters were waiting for their husbands to return from sea. Which, of course, is where the song The Three Fishers comes from. Presumably they were married to the three sisters, and you say that their stars are actually in the constellation Perseus. We're learning a huge amount today. Thank you very much. Then, also, while we're driving along, while you guys are in the mood to teach me things, which is always the best mood for you to be in, there was a plant last year and every year that we couldn't find, that I think Judy H. you found for us, if you're watching. It's got a white flower, and it smells like diesel. And I can never remember its name, and I wondered if you wouldn't be, if you'd be so kind, if it's on the top of your head, to tweet that through to us. Hashtag Safari Live. Question to wilder.tv. Terms and conditions apply. Batteries not included. Accessories sold separately. In fact, in order to make your product useful at all, you will have to buy at least and spend double. That's just my bitterness at commerce, everyone. Jen B, I'm just losing the final control slightly here, but I think you said that the Seven Oaks translates loosely to long luck. Where does that come from? Yes, good, we got that correct. Thank you, Jen B. Faith, hope, and charity, wives of the three fishers. Beautiful song, that of the three fishers. Now we're coming into the second clearings here, where the great cheetah that was mentioned will hopefully be here. An unusual amount of bird song, I feel, for a day like this. Cloudy and, well, in any other part of the world, be called miserable. It's a great joy over this part of the world. We had some golden-breasted buntings. I think they've gone, haven't they, Brian? You got them? Oh, you're a genius. Golden-breasted bunting, everybody. Beautiful picture thereof. Here it goes. It's just up ahead there. Did you catch it? Unbelievable. The speed that Brian is able to find things. It was, that's exactly where it went. I think it's moved again. Yeah, it has. It's just flown now off to the left. Good. Not to be confused with the cinnamon-breasted bunting, which of course has a breast the colour of?
Cinnamon.
Yes, cinnamon, exactly. Well done. How did you know that, Brian? Is it just your experience?
Yeah.
Yes.
Random lucky guess.
Random lucky guess. Yes, Louise, we are still hearing you. That looks like a fairly ominous cloud, doesn't it? That's it. Thank you, Judy H. Pterodendron ternatum is the diesel-smelling white flower. Pterodendron. Pterodendron. Clerodendron, sorry, clerodendron. Yes, clerodendron. 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 I'll have to write that down as soon as I return home. Thank you, Judy. Never lets me down. There is nothing in these clearings, is there, Brian? Not unless it is invisible. This does not surprise me, for clearings on a cool day like this, not the best place to be. You catch the wind. Get pneumonia. All right, we're going to do a quick turn down through the clearings here, and then I think we'll probably head back towards Djuma and see if there's any space with the Queen. knows? Who knows? I haven't even seen any little coursers or birds flying around here. We'll just stop up here and have a little listen. Now, an excellent question from I Walk in the Rain. Yes, everybody, that is the Twitter handle, I Walk in the Rain. You say, do we get Cory Bustards here? Yes, we do from time to time. I've not seen one on Safari Live. Have you, Brian? No. But they are around, the world's heaviest flying bird. I've seen them in the south. I'm not sure. Have they been seen on Safari Live? They have. In fact, they have definitely been seen. They've been seen on the Arethusa airstrip. Now, I'm just going to look around here, scan the clearings. I should probably do that with the binoculars, though. Let's see if we can't find some jackals lying or cheetah on the fringes. Not sure where that cheetah report came from. But I didn't see any cheetah. Do you, Brian? No. Very disappointing. Can't hear anything either. It's very silent. It's very peaceful. It'd be a good place to set up a small breakfast, don't you think, Brian? Yes. There are some guinea fowl way at the far end there, but they are not shouting as they were at Karula and her offspring. Thank you, Dispatch Griffin. You say the golden-breasted bunting is number 44 for your bird list. Good. Well, your bird list is going to get substantially larger as we head into the summer. Dispatch Griffin. The Three Sisters. I'm so glad that art question has been answered for me. Right, Tayla is still on her way to the lions. I'm not sure if she's made it there yet. Maybe her car is broken. Anyway, let's go and find out.
Frosty's not broken just yet. We have a look down there. You can see there's all these impala, lots and lots of them around here. Now, apparently that lion is in the distance. Now, we may be able to off-road here because this is a very nice sandy crest area, lots of marula trees and things. So it's very well-drained soil, not like the soil that we had when I was trying to find the Nkhumas. Oh, there he is. There we come. Now, listen to all the impala. There he is. Those impala are not hanging around that lion. There must be easy about 100 impala in this herd. It is a massive group. I'm gonna go back again, see if we can catch him. But wasn't that beautiful? I'm gonna be quite quick with my little actions here, so I wanna get round as quick as possible. That's exactly what I was hoping for, was to just catch him moving in the distance and then to see the reaction of all those impala. Let's see, okay, so they're still looking and snorting. Let's see if we get another gap of him. There's, like I said, there's a whole lot of impala around here. See, they're still looking. You can see we are surrounded. I think I saw him. Let's find another gap. There might even be more than 100 impala here. There's just impala everywhere. Here we go. I'm going to go up further ahead. all the impala are now scattering around. We're just trying to get a good view of him, of course. Let's see. Oh, there he is. He's going up and down at the moment. He's just disappeared behind that tree. You can see the movement there. Listen to those impala. Look how they're all staring at him. We'll go in a moment. Ears all perked, watching. Now, like I said, this is actually a fine area for us to go into. The other area where we were with the Nkhumas earlier was a black cotton soil, which is not great. So let's make our way in now. Like I said, the sandy soils that you see in these areas, these are alright to drive on. This is fine. It's because it is well drained, the water doesn't sort of hang around. There's not a very high clay content. Now when you have a lot of clay in the soil, that obviously becomes a big problem. And that's when you create sort of further erosion on the ground. You're creating roads, you're destroying the vegetation. We just need to try and find a way in here now. We'll go over this little shrub here, or this fallen log, and we'll get a view. But his movements are very erratic at the moment. He's zigzagging, going up, going down, doing circles. So he's smelling something. I don't know what scent he is. Maybe he's looking for the females. Maybe he's picked up on another male. Here he is here. But he's on the move. Let's just try and get into a gap. There he is. I can't tell you who it is just yet. Impala still watching carefully, still alarm calling. And it actually seems as though the impala are moving closer, which is quite typical. Now, who have we got? Is it Tino? I didn't see a big scar in his face. Let's have a look. We'll try and get a good view of him, though, before we try and identify him. Now, Brett, you're wondering... Come on, Jigger. Well, James, you may have jinxed me, because Jigger doesn't want to go into reverse this morning. Here he comes again. Now, Brett, sorry, you want to know how much do lions weigh? Well, this beautiful male lion probably weighs in excess of 200 kilograms. But a female lion, normally around 150 to about 160 kilograms, is a decent size. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I think the largest male ever recorded was about 250 kilograms, which is ginormous. Now, this is quite tricky maneuvering here. Darby, we're just going to go through a couple of trees. There he comes again. Go to try and get around him here. I apologize, I do need to just try and concentrate. There's quite a few terminalias, so silver cluster leaf, which do make it difficult to try and navigate through. Right, sneak through here. You're good, Darby? Just watch the one on the right. It's got a couple of prickly thorns. Here he is. Hello. And it seems to be Mr. Tino. Looks like it, doesn't it? You can see the, not the nicest skin. Now he's smelling. I don't know what he's smelling. Let's see where he's going. He won't be able to catch these impala, I don't think, because they know he's here. They're shouting at him. They are moving away. Some of them were coming a bit closer to make sure that they don't lose sight of him and they can keep watching him where he decides to go. But let's carry on. Let's not lose him. Just need to listen to the game drive radio. There's a... I think someone... Oi, let's go over here. Now, I do apologize if I don't talk too much. I need to just try and get through. Are you okay, David, here? Good. It's just a little shrub. Let's try and keep up with him because I can't see him anymore. Okay, I'm going to try and get back on the road. He's going towards the road again because it's getting quite thick in here, of course. That's what's so nice about Rusty, Jigger and Wendy is they are so zippy. Right, onto the road we go. Hopefully we're going to catch him now. He was going along here, he was sort of just, here he is. Hello big boy. Gonna get in front of him. Let's go up ahead and get him walking towards us. Here he is. Beautiful big man. Look how lovely his mane is starting to look. You can see the dark colors coming through nicely. It's got long and quite thick on the chest. Darkening on top of the head. They really are starting to look like lovely lions now, the Birminghams. He's contact calling. And now he's marking as he goes along. Still trying to pick up on a scent of, I don't know who he's looking for. Perhaps he's trying to relocate the rest of the pride again. Seems as though all the impala have now moved right out of the way. It's gone very quiet. Hello, Duck Dodgers, who is a new viewer with us today. Welcome, and we hope you continue watching. Now, you're wondering, why don't these lions just not pay us any attention? Now, that's because we've been interacting in the vehicles with these animals for over 30 years, so they've almost become habituated to us. So not as humans, the human figure when you're out on foot, but in the vehicle. They're used to the big solid shapes and the noises we make and the different smells that they get. So they've become very much relaxed around the vehicles now. Of course, every animal, like humans, they have moods. Some days they may be more relaxed around you than others. So you've just got to read their behavior. It's just incredible when he does do that contact call. It's so much louder than the females. But let's hear if he does it again. Perfect. That actually suits us because the next sort of section of thicket that he was going into would have been a nightmare to try and follow him. So I'm glad he's had a little break and has sat down next to us. Thank you. That wasn't a very good attempt at a call. He didn't make any sound. He just opened his mouth. No, now it seems as though he doesn't want to make the noise at all. Hello, Lelani, who has also recently only just started watching Safari Live. Welcome again, and we're so glad that you are continuing to watch. Now, you'd like to know how many prides or lions are in the area, and do I know exactly how many individuals are in each pride? Well, we really only see the Nkhumas, which consists of 5 adult lionesses and 8 cubs of various ages and sexes. And then we see the Birmingham males, which are 4 males. There used to be 5, but unfortunately one died because of injuries that he sustained from a buffalo. Now this is Tinyo, one of the Birminghams. You can see he's got a scar. It's hard to see it now, but when he looks towards us, you can see he's got a scar on his lip. Almost actually healing really well there. You can't see it. If he looks towards us, you see it quite nicely. And the reason why he was called Tinyo was because at one point that scar sort of left a big gap in his flesh, and you could see his canine sticking out. So Tinyo means tooth. We also see that Salalas, which was 2 females and 3 males, young boys though. Then every now and then the Torchwood Pride, I'm not sure how many they consist of though. They seem to be much further east. And then the Styx, which is 3 adult lionesses, and I'm uncertain as to how many cubs they have now. Unfortunately, they did have 8 little cubs, but they all passed on due to an outbreak of mange. But I believe that one female has actually given birth, and I believe it's 2 cubs, if I'm not mistaken. So if you look on the top of his shoulder, can you see how he's got that sort of bit of skin that's missing there? Well, not skin, hair. Now, we believe that he was the source as to who started the outbreak and the spread of mange. He's looking for something. Maybe he's looking for Mfumo, the other one of his brothers. Maybe he's having a look for them. Maybe he is trying to find the lionesses, but he's quite far off of them. I'm going to go forward very quickly. So I'm not sure, but he's hasn't got a clear scent, I'm afraid. My goodness, he's weaving back into the thicket again. Whew, here we go, round 2. And I'm pretty sure he's probably going to do another loop and come back out again. Let's try this again though. Now we need to try and find a spot to keep up with him. All right, David, are you all right here? Watch that wattle. Luckily there's no thorn trees, just a few annoying branches in the way, but we'll duck and dive underneath them. Luckily, it seems to open up a little bit up ahead, so hopefully we can catch him before he disappears into another terminalia thicket. Those are hard to navigate through. But whoever he's looking for, he's very confused. So perhaps he started off, he had the scent quite strong, and he's now lost it completely because he's calling. It's like I said, it's a very loud contact call. Normally the contact calls are very slow. The male lions obviously have a much deeper, more gruff voice. Oh, trying to find a gap here. Let's go here. He's going into a thicket again. Unfortunately, that sort of open clearing was very much short-lived. Bit of water in my face from the branches. Okay, we've got him again. He seems to have slowed down. Oh my goodness, David, I just have to show you something pretty incredible. Can you see? Let's see if we can focus in. I know we're going to take the attention off of the lion. There is a caterpillar or an inchworm or something that has got stuck in a spider's web. Can we see it? It's hard to see it. Hey, David? just up here. Let's see if I just want to show you, because this is quite, there we go. If, yeah, it is to the left. Look at this that we've just come across. Now, I'm going to actually have to change my route because I don't want to ruin this little spider. What is that? Is it, it doesn't actually look like a worm. It looks like something else. I can see little antennas and looks like little, and some legs. And a very small little spider, maybe a little bark spider. Is it a grasshopper, David? It looks like it could be something along those lines. It's a bizarre looking creature. Maybe it is a grasshopper. And I'm actually going to have to go all the way around because I don't want to destroy this little one's nest. Well, I think we will take it down here. Isn't that incredible? And this is what you find. You're driving around. You don't know what you're going to see. We've got a lion in front of us. And then we come across this beautiful creature with its breakfast. But I think let's leave it and we'll find another way around. We'll try not, obviously we don't want to harm that little guy and ruin that big meal, which probably sustained that spider for quite some time. So we will go another way around. A couple of U-turns and, sorry, little trees. As we squeeze through this gap, I think we've already come through here. Right, let's go around and go the way that Lex went. I think that'll be quite nice, and I think he's established an easier way in. And we just need to try and get ahead of him again. Well, he's turning back. Right, let's squeeze through here. He's going straight towards those impala again. He's not hunting the impala, of course. He's just looking for them. We're literally doing exactly the same loop we've just done. Have you realized this, David? We just come around and over this termite mound. Watch your head here. Wait. He's so sneaky. And he's obviously going back around, checking the same spots twice. I think he's trying to see where he messed up, where he lost the scent. Which is obviously quite clever, because if you go round and round and round, I'm sure eventually you'll pick up on where your mistake was. Oh my goodness, he's motoring through the bush. He goes so quickly. It's just incredible how these animals, they don't struggle like we struggle in these big vehicles. But he's coming back onto the road again, I think, so we'll maybe catch him again on the road. Here he is. Here he comes. Hello, big boy. Now, William was wondering if there's any sort of rules about guides wearing colognes or perfumes while on drive. Not really. In the vehicle, it doesn't really matter so much. But if you're going for a bushwalk, well, I wouldn't recommend that you cover yourself with perfume. Obviously, everything is going to smell you coming, and the idea is to stay hidden. Here he goes, walking right behind the vehicle, as you can see. Oh my goodness, right here. And it doesn't make too much of a difference, but it's also, I mean, if I don't think it's particularly nice. It's nice to just have a little bit so you smell okay, I suppose. But nothing out here minds what you really smell like. But I'm sure that these lions are used to, and all the different animals are used to, what strange things that we wear. Now, Dispatch Griffin would like to know, if we were to come across the lions on foot, how much danger would we be in? It really does depend on the situation. If it's an open area, I wouldn't be too worried. If you bumped into them into a very thick area with lots of trees and they were on a kill and all the cubs were there, well, then you probably are going to try and find yourself in a bit of trouble, because the mothers will protect their cubs as well as they'll be trying to protect their meal. If you walk into an area where it's also, again, very dense, they don't need to be on a kill or anything like that, and their only escape route is the way in which you've come in, you can imagine they have nothing else they can do but act aggressively towards you. So you'll be listening out for growling. Their ears will be flat against their head, and they'll also be moving their tail around, sort of from side to side and up and down. And these are all agitation signs, of course. Lions are notorious for mock charging, though. The thing about a lion charge, or a mock charge, is that they'll come at you sort of very tall, making lots of noise, trying to kick dust up and try and scare you. But those mock charges, they often stop just a couple of meters away from you. Whereas if it's a real charge, they're coming in low, probably not making too much noise at all. And well, then you're going to get yourself into trouble. Now he's gone into this block, which I was hoping he wasn't going to go into. It's a big drainage system, and I don't know if we're going to, unfortunately, be able to keep up with him. It sort of starts to... I'm just going to move off the road so Lex can go past quickly. Let me just go up ahead. It's still a little bit of a sandy crest, but on the other side, unfortunately, it's not. I'll see if I can try and get him again, but let's go back across to James for an update.
There's something wrong with me. Hello, everybody. Sorry, Ryan and I were just being very silly, and then I realized that, in fact, there must be some kind of psychological issue with me. We're heading back sort of towards Karula there, and we're going to see if we can get into the sighting. Who's in charge of sighting of Karula? Right, what we're going to do is we're going to go along here and along the fire break, because that's going to give us our best view, I think. And if there are other vehicles from the other channels there, in other words, from the boundary, on the other side of the boundary, then we'll just move out if there are too many cars. Right, let's have a pleasant little jaunt along here. And there, everybody, my favorite tree just coming into leaf, Manilkara mochisa, the low-felt milk berry, whose fruits are supposedly quite delicious, but I've yet to eat one. A knocking noise, disturbing still in the engine. Ted in Pennsylvania. Very complicated story about the three sisters and where they originally came from. What were their names again, Louise?
Andrew, come in.
Clotho, Latisus, and Tropos. Right. Atropos and Latisus. Right, okay, I'm going to have to do some reading on that. It's very complicated names for the radio. And they come from Greek mythology, do they? The daughters of whom? All right, here we are. Just going to talk to Lex quickly.
Okay, thank you, Andrew. We're going to stop for proper work then.
She should be just down here. What I don't want to do is just kind of blunder into the sighting and cause consternation. We'll just drive very slowly down here. I do see vehicles there. Let's see how many there are. Looks like a Cheetah Plains car. Station in control of Karula sighting. No one's answering. Confirm, Aubrey. Forbes, how many vehicles there? Sorry, I've been calling. I couldn't get hold of anyone.
Yeah, keep going.
Okay, copy then. Apparently we can keep going. That's good news. Excellent. We're going to have a nice view, yeah? There we go. Hello, Jason. Jason, you're wondering about Shadow, and I am too. You're not alone, and you're... That's not me taking pictures, everybody. That is the sound of machine gun fire motor drive on the other vehicle. My camera doesn't take pictures that fast. Sorry, Jason, I was distracted there. I thought we were under fire for 1 second. I don't know where Shadow is. I haven't heard any updates on her. We haven't been, however, to Cheetah Plains, not Cheetah Plains, to Arethusa for some time because we actually don't have any communication there. So it could be that she's been seen once or twice around there, but I haven't heard anything from anybody. So, yeah, it really is quite, worrying, I guess, because Karula spent a lot of time in her territory. The Ingridan female has been up and around the area. So, yeah, I don't know. Oh, Brian, there's a hornbill nest right there on this dead tree. I'm going to sneak forward slightly there. And that little hornbill is feeding something in the slit. In that slit. The hornbill is just up. I'm just going to see what it's caught. Looks like a scorpion. And it's just breaking it up a bit, I think. It is a scorpion. Was a scorpion. Sorry to distract you from the leopards, everybody, but that was quite interesting. Anyway, I'll keep an eye on the hornbill. We can go back to the male leopard is now flinging himself all over the kill as he was when we arrived the first time. Can you hear that? We're just going to turn up so that you can hear the number of photographs being taken. It's quite astounding. And they're also getting an incredible performance from this young male leopard, though, aren't they? Oh, is that Xongile now? I just assumed it was the male because it was him earlier on. Karula sits patiently watching her offspring. That's so cool. And you could just see the speed with which those little muscles move. Incredible speed, incredible flexibility, agility, vicious claws. Biting jaws. This is just unbelievable. Good heavens. I mean, how many of the same picture can you edit? I suppose I only say that because my camera won't do the same thing. Oh, this is just too special. What are you doing, you silly little fellow? That's her. That's Mrs. That's Xongile. The male has obviously given up playing here. All right, everybody, I'm afraid another vehicle has just pulled into the sighting, so we're going to press on. We don't want to have four vehicles in the sighting. So we're going to head gently on. While we do that, we'll head across to Tayla, who is back with the line, and we'll come back to Karula as soon as the afternoon drive starts.
I think we're about to lose this male. He's disappearing into the drainage line and he's been vocalizing quite a bit, so he's definitely looking for the rest of the pride. I don't know if we're going to get another view. Let's try and get out of here. I don't even know if I'm okay. Well, we'll go until we hear. Am I good behind you, David? Sorry, I can't see. Perfect. Right, let's see if we can get him again. If he does go into this drainage line, then we're going to have to leave him, unfortunately. Some of the soils are right around here, quite sandy, but as soon as it gets to the other side of the drainage, it turns into that sort of cotton soil, which is not ideal to drive on. And I was chatting to Lex, he actually seems to think we got a bit more rain than we thought. He thinks it's about 30 mils of rain or so, which is fantastic. Isn't that wonderful? Let's see. Now, he was coming down here, but he could have changed direction because my goodness, he is far ahead of us. We have to pick up the pace a little bit. Whee! And there he is in front of us. There's even a giraffe in the distance that's now running away. I don't know if you're going to catch it. Now, we're seeing this beautiful big boy on his own, and I know that Roger was wondering this morning, are lions the only family cats that we see living in family groups? And that is indeed correct. Sometimes it can be a bit difficult. You may think that cheetahs are quite social because you'll often see mom and all of her cubs, but this is not the case. Those cubs will eventually leave her and go off on their own as well, so it is indeed just the lions. That's what makes them so successful too, is living in groups. Of course, it gives him a better opportunity to take something down. Now, maybe he's going to lead us straight towards the pride. It seems as though he's either on a scent, or maybe the lioness has responded to his calls. Let's carry on. Oh, sorry, I just took my foot off the brake. I'm on a bit of a slope, but let's carry on. Let's keep up with him. Don't want to lose him again. Come on, do another big roar for us. And what I really like about him now is that you can see how lovely dark grey his body is actually going. He's looking. He's not sure where to go. He has a suspicion. He keeps looking down into this drainage, which is sort of the area where we lost the lionesses earlier today. Give him a bit of room. We're going to just keep slowly following him. Though Rusty doesn't know how to go slowly, I'm going to have to go into 4x4 quickly, and then we will just crawl along. That's better. So if your screen does get a bit jumpy, we are just going to keep up with him, because at any moment he could turn off and disappear down into this drainage. So I'm, like I said, I'm literally just crawling behind him. I've given him quite a bit of space, about 20 to 30 meters or so. And you can see he's quite comfortable with the distance between us and him. Whee! Over a little bump we go. Now, no squeaky brakes, don't start now. We go into first gear and we'll crawl even slower. He's sort of slowed down his pace quite a bit now. Now, Peter, you're wondering if there are any animals that we are scared of. I'm not particularly fond of elephant bulls in must. So that is when they get to that sort of excited state and they're wanting to mate with the females and they become quite boisterous. Now, that is probably my least favorite animal to encounter. And then on foot, I'm obviously a bit nervous of buffalo, especially buffalo bulls that are on their own, or the odd hippo can be quite interesting too. I'm going to pull off the side here. He's missioning down this road. But scared, I wouldn't say scared is the right word to use. Just sort of cautious, I think, is a better one to use. Let's see if he's going to call it. Yes. I was hoping he was going to do a full roar there, but unfortunately just a little bit. But Andrew, you're welcome to jump ahead. Playing leapfrog now with the lion because he's walking down on the middle of the road, which makes it quite difficult to view him. So we're going to let Andrew just get a good view as well with his guests. Anna Marie, I like your cheering on, and I agree with you, and I think that Tinio needs to give us a big roar. He's building up to something, so perhaps we're going to get lucky. Let's go around quickly. Oh, so he's chosen not to go down Vulture's Nest. Now, I thought that that would have been the next best move. Now, we've been seeing Tinio and Mfumo hanging around with the Birmingham Pride quite often. I know that Anna was wondering exactly this. Is there any specific Birmingham that hangs around, or do they just take turns? We don't often see Nena and Nsuku, the old blondie, really coming around. Yeah, I've only seen Nena a couple of times. But it seems to be Tinio and then, of course, Mfumo that are the dominant males of the Nkhuma Pride. The others seem to hang around the sticks and a little bit further east. But there's obviously definite opportunities for them to come through over here, though, and obviously see the lovely Nkhumas. There's also some wattled starlings in the road in front of Tinio. You can see them there. And they'll probably love the fact that he comes strolling along and those insects will all sort of fly up off the ground. But there are lots and lots of birds you can see flying past him. Maybe there's even a little mound here that's spewing out some alates. And that's why they're all sort of congregating in this area. Looks like he's going to quench his thirst. No, not really going to quench his thirst. Okay, turn your volume up. Wasn't that absolutely incredible to finally get him raw? And I'm sure you saw all that mist coming off of his, out of his mouth as he was doing that. That was fantastic. We'll stick with him for a little bit longer. Let's go across to James, who's got a buffalo.
that is Beefy, everybody. He's very close by, and he is a ropey-looking fellow. Now, I thought these chaps would put on condition much faster than they have. I guess the fact that he's quite old maybe indicates why he's not putting on condition. But these are two deeply ancient buffalo, and they are looking hippie. They're looking a bit skinny. They're browsing. They're not even eating grass at the moment. And in fact, the first one, not that one, the other one, was eating baboon's tail when we arrived here, which I have not seen many animals eating. Look at the hips. You can sort of see them sticking out there through the sticks. So they really don't look great, these chaps. And you can also hear the call of the white-browed scrub robin in the background. And they, of course, are in mortal danger from two things. Firstly, the Nkhuma pride. Secondly, if Taylor were to come across them, the Nkhuma pride would almost certainly kill them immediately. She's had such unbelievable luck with them killing buffalo in front of her. So if I were them, I'd try and avoid both. Because one comes with the other. Now, why they should have chosen to be eating along the drainage line here as opposed to sort of heading up onto the ridge crests or into those ecotones, remember, exactly like the water buck were doing, I don't know. Maybe they've just given up, Brian. Mm. Maybe they don't think there's any point anymore.
Yeah. Likely.
They can't keep up with the herd. They're not big enough to fight for mating opportunities. Lions are everywhere. There's nothing good to eat because of the drought. Hang in, Beefy. We've had some good rain last night. I'm sure that's going to make a difference to your life fairly soon. Oh, and the red-chested cuckoo starting to call in the background now. That's just because it's warming up a bit. There it goes. There's a little bit of sky breaking through the clouds. And all the birds like to sing when the sun comes out, don't they, Brian?
They do.
There's also Diedrich's cuckoo going. Gorgeous, gorgeous summer's morning. Let us continue. Yes, now, Siberia Zumi, you've made a very good comment about all the cameras that were on the back of that specialist photographic safari that was going on next to us. Siberia Zumi, you say... you say it sounded like somebody's very own personal popcorn machine. It sounded exactly like that, yes. I just hate to think of the administration heading across and trying to sort out all of those pictures. Here we go. Now Cheryl, Cheryl and Maya, who came to see us, when was it? It was on the weekend, I think. They were on the same photographic trip as this current group are on now, with the same guides. And on the same trip, Cheryl took 3,000 photographs and Maya took 10,000 photographs over a period of 4 days. So that is an astounding amount of editing that they're going to have to do. Good luck with that, chaps. Then you watch a chap like Lex Hess, of course, who's been taking wildlife photographs for, well, the best part of 40 years now. He's got his camera on the front of the car, and he takes it out maybe once a drive, and when he does, you know that there's something worth taking a photograph of. He goes, chick, once, no motor drive, just chick, and he puts it down. And then when that photograph is produced, it's outstanding. Now, I most certainly don't have anything like that kind of talent, so I'm more in the motor drive speed, or motor drive class. Yes. Cheryl, and I think that you're going to find that this current group is going to outdo even you and Mayer. The number of photographs being taken of that leopard right now. I find that for every 100 photographs I take, and I mean I don't have a motor drive at all, I probably like about 4 or 5. The rest I get rid of. And I was saying to Graham, I was telling Graham Wallington that the other day, he said you mustn't delete any of them because, you know, you might decide that they're art one day. I've decided that very quickly I can see whether mine are art or not. But you've got to take lots of pics in order, of course, to... You've got to take lots of pics in order to find the good ones. Right, we're going to leave you now, hand you over to Taylor and her lion for the last few minutes. Thanks for coming on Drive, everybody. We'll be back live again for our second day from 4 to 7 this afternoon. Until then, goodbye from me and, of course, the business thumb.
Now, Mr. Tinio has decided to settle down. He's just resting up for a moment, and I don't blame him. He's covered a huge distance in such a small space of time. And he hasn't done any more roaring since you last saw him. But something that I find that's quite funny, and I've mentioned it before, how I don't think that the Nkhumas in particular enjoy the company of the Birminghams. We often seem to see a lot of sort of agitation between all of them. And no one has responded to his calls. Not one lion. None of the females. And we know that they're just somewhere here in this drainage system. They're not far. They've sat very, very quietly. And I've seen this behavior a couple of times. I often chat about how the Charlestons and the Southern Pride have a similar relationship like the Nkhumas do with the Birminghams. I think the Nkhumas would be quite happy without the Birminghams. But then what would these poor Birminghams eat if they didn't have all those beautiful ladies catching them dinner all the time, or lunch or breakfast? The only difference between the two, and I've yet to see the Birmingham boys really do a good takedown on anything, is that the Charleston boys were incredible hunters, and they would often leave the Pride and go off on territorial missions, and we'd come across them, on just the two of them on their own, without the rest of the Pride, and they'd have their meal. They'd have a buffalo, they'd have zebra, kudu, you name it. So they were very, very, very good at taking down their own food. Now, we saw Mr. Tinio walking around quite a bit, smelling the ground, and of course, when he did that beautiful belting roar, he also then marked a territory. Now, Melinda, you're wondering, what causes a lion to mark in a specific place? Well, it depends. If there were lions in the area previously, they would have come through on usually main roads and just marked around every so often. The Birminghams probably would have picked up on those old scents that the previous male lions, where they were marking, and they would have marked over those. Like I say, if it's a new lion, a new area, there's never been lions there before, he'll go on a patrol and just mark anywhere. I don't think there's anything specific or certain about it. He'll just go wherever he's walking, he's going to leave his scent, whether it's rubbing on his face or his sort of cheek glands, or if he's going to spray urine up against a tree, or both. They'll do that quite often as well. Now, it'll be interesting to see what happens this afternoon on safari, if we find the Nkhumas with the Birmingham, or if we're just going to find Tinio all on his own still, scouring the plains of Djuma in search of the beautiful Nkhuma pride. Now, Aqua is commenting on Tinio's roar that he did for us earlier. He said that it's got a rip rattle at the end of his roar. I definitely think it sounds very, very raspy. He's got a beautiful roar, but the most beautiful call of a lion I've ever heard was from one of the four-ways male lions, which I believe they're now sort of in the Kruger and the Jock concession. They live down there, but they used to once live in the southwestern corner of the Sabi Sand. There were two brothers, and they were beautiful. And he had the most unbelievable roar I've ever heard. The way that Tinyo's roar sort of ended, his roar started like that. It was just raspy and loud, and the vehicle vibrated, and it was just absolutely incredible from start right through until the end. Now, it seems as though the clouds have lifted. I can see some blue sky popping out as well, which is good news for us this afternoon. So hopefully the sun will come through and start to dry the ground up. But unfortunately, we're getting to that part of the show where myself and David are actually going to have to leave you. And, well, it's been a fantastic morning again. I'm so glad we managed to find the Nkhumas, Karula, her cubs, Tinyo. It's been amazing as usual. We'll see you again this afternoon for the Sunset Safari.